Welcome to the Automators Podcast with your host, Jackie Stook and Joe Glines.
Hey, so today we're going to cover the use of voice commands in our everyday lives.
Cut! Oh, it didn't work.
Hey, everybody. So it's Jackie here with the...
How's it going, Jackie? What are we talking about today?
We're talking about voice commands and the use of them in our everyday lives.
Yeah. So let me just jump in here real quickly. We were having, you know, when we start our talk, we always just catch up with how things are going, talk about our lives. And I had said, hey, I was talking with Ryan Wells the other day about using voice commands, and I had this script, and that's the URL over my head here. And if I'm going to jump to it, just say, not that we're going to dive into the code, but we can see what is in there, if I can find, oh, here we go. Yeah, so this is the script, which I have, like, if you go to the URL, you can download the script. And here, we're using AutoHotkey with the built-in in Windows. I think it starts with 10, I could be wrong. Do you know, Jackie, is Windows 7 or 8 have the CEPI?
I think 7 at least have it, yeah.
Okay.
I remember using it on 7.
Okay. I remember using the voice-to-text thing, but not the actual, like, recognizing... You know, me with the comm module. But anyway, this relies on that technology. And here I can pass it, like, run a notepad, and it will go down to the subroutine, run notepad, which just basically says run notepad. But it's pretty cool. The problem was I was having a lot of false positives with it. And so Tank and I were chatting, and he said he thinks if we, you know, add in that profile, it should help. And Jackie actually spotted another tool we were reviewing. They have a threshold kind of measure, and so hopefully if we dive into this a little bit more some other time, not in this podcast, we can see that threshold. Maybe I can set it at a certain level where it doesn't have so many false positives. But so there we go. Now let's go back into the point of the topic. Jackie and I started talking about, hey, where do you use voice commands, and would you use them at work, and what were you saying, Jackie, about, you know, your use, like, at work, would you actually use one?
Yeah, the thing is the environment you are in, and we, maybe 6 months ago or something like that, got our first, you know, smart speakers with Google Voice commands, and we're using them a fair amount at home. But I was like, would I actually use that at work? Depending on whichever setting, and we were talking about the use of AutoHotkey, and it's often to customize your day-to-day whatever at work, or your workflow, or whatever it might be. And we love the idea of using this Windows voice recognition to do stuff on your computer. And hopefully a lot of people are using AutoHotkey in their work tasks. But is there a place for voice commands at work? And of course, if you have your own office, or if you're working at home or stuff like that, it might work great for you to have a few that you could run notepad or take a quick note or whatever it might be. But if you're in an environment where there's lots of people around you, you might not want to speak to your computer in weird ways to get it to do pretty simple things. But then again, we also thought, yeah, there might actually be situations. One of them I thought of was at work, I need to always lock my computer before I leave it. And I'm sure lots of workplaces have rules like that. But often I do actually get up from my desk and walk out to get, let's say, a cup of coffee. And it's 30 meters that way, and it takes a few moments. And I don't always remember to lock my computer. And sometimes I remember within a few steps, oh, I didn't lock it. Oh, you know what? Doesn't matter. I'll be back in a few moments. But in reality, I should still not leave my workstation with my computer open that way. With a voice command, I could actually tell it to lock the screen or whatever. That's one of the few situations where I would actually say that it would make sense for me to not have to go back and forth and stuff like that.
I was laughing earlier because a good friend of mine, his friend would come over in office out of his house at times. And his friend, I forget if he had carpal tunnel or what, but he did almost everything with voiced the dragon's naturally speaking actions. And it really interrupted my friend's, ability to work, because this other guy would come to his house and then constantly be talking out loud, saying these things. And not only that he's talking, it's that he's, to your point, it's talking in a particular pattern that makes your brain go, it's just, it's weird. So it's more disruptive than just a normal conversation. Plus he also apparently would talk very loud. Now, and then the other thing, this is where I thought it was really interesting of talking about, with auto hotkey, the really, really cool thing, of course, not talking about voice of text, just in general, is that if I don't like the hotkeys that a given program has, I can make whatever makes sense to me and then tell it to send, adapt it to that program. The tools that we both have, like a Google Home and the Echo, they have wake words or, alert words, the trigger words that will, they won't be, they say they were there. Of course, they still have to be listening, right? Because they would never hear themselves be triggered. But they force you to have these certain words that you have to use. And then even like the trigger command thing I had mentioned earlier, that you can download a program to your computer and configure it with the cloud and with Echo. And then you could speak something and you'd say like, Alexa, tell trigger command to start whatever. And it would actually run on your computer, which is really cool. But it's so many things to try to remember to force you to talk in a certain way that I'm like, I can't get myself to do it.
Yeah, in most cases, you would probably love to have a specific sentence. You might still want to have a trigger word because that probably makes the most sense. Something that people don't say too often in conversation might also be a good idea. But in general, just having that fully customizable option of what you want to say to have whichever command happen. And I know there are probably different options, plugins, and I don't remember what they're called for the Echo, but there's quite a lot of stuff you can put in extra to get extra functionality. But still, most people don't have an Echo beside them at work to get actions to happen on their computer. A mic, on the other hand, most people probably have that in some way or some form, working on Windows, at least if they're hotkey enthusiasts, that's probably a given. So yeah, you can really do some amazing stuff and customize it in so many ways, but it doesn't seem as if the voice recognition parts of these pieces of code that we've seen on the forum, stuff like that, has been utilized much.
Yeah. Well, and I can see the examples that I saw with Voice Attack, which is what Ryan Wells had mentioned. It was a pretty interesting program, and it is pretty cool, and it was very accurate in its triggers on when I was doing stuff. The example it had was people were playing a video game, and they could tell the computer, turn on this type of site or turn on this missile or, shoot missile, instead of having to remember the hotkey or whatever. And maybe you're doing a couple other things with your hands already in a game and you want to say what you're thinking. Actually, Jackie, I know you're roughly 10 years younger than I am, but do you remember the Clint Eastwood movie Firefox? Firefox?
Yeah, I do remember that one where he needed to think in Russian. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, because the plane was listening to his thoughts and he had to think in Russian. And it was like, at the time, that was what, 25, 30 years ago? 30 years ago, probably.
Yeah, I think it is.
Dude. Yeah. Well ahead of its time. It's funny, is like now it's actually probably something they're doing. But it is one of those things, like it can, I think, have its place. And of course, for you and I, we're really corporate America kind of people, where you're working with other people around you. So I think normally those circumstances, you're right, it's not going to be very often that I would want to have that, because also, unless at some point that profile gets to be good enough to be able to clearly understand, like, how you said, like, you could lock your computer, but you probably wouldn't want to have it unlock your computer unless it could really tell you, your voice frequency. But of course, someone could record it, right? Because I don't know how they would, you know, lock that down. That would be a pretty big security risk for unlocking. But still, it's at some point, it would be pretty cool if you could make sure it's you. Because I know that Echo actually learns you compared to other people. And it'll, so you say, show me my calendar, and it will show you the right calendar, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah, I know that Google does the same, and we've tested it a few times with guests and stuff. It won't tell them any of our personal information. It won't tell them what's in our calendars or anything like that if it doesn't recognize our voice match. But yeah, we need to set that up first. But as soon as it's recognized us, that works pretty well. It can also recognize my kids. So yeah, not that they have access to that type of information.
And I know I didn't do it before this call, but I know I had read, you know, like the number of Google searches and YouTube searches that are done from voice actuated stuff is really taken off. You know, it's much more common now compared to 5 years ago, right? Now, would it ever surpass, you know, input from a keyboard or, you know, something like that? Boy, I don't know. But you know, you watch Star Trek, where they've been doing that forever, where they talk to the computer, and you know, you have high hopes.
I'd say, sure, there is quite a few times after getting a smart speaker myself where I'm like, let's say I'm interacting with my Chromecast and something is playing, and I don't know whatever it might be, I need to get up for some reason. Instead of looking for my phone, it might be in my pocket, it might be on the table, but I need to get my phone, I need to unlock my phone, I need to get into the app, and the app needs to connect and see, oh, I have a Chromecast session running, and then I'll wait, and I can press pause. And instead of that, I can say, Google, yep, pause Chromecast 3, or whatever command I use, and we'll do it. It happens almost instantly. There's no waiting. I don't need to fiddle around with my phone. And when I get back, I've gotten what I needed to drink or been to the bathroom or whatever it might have been. I just say, hey, blah, 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 turn on Chromecast 3 or press play, whatever it might be. To me, that works amazingly well. You can turn off some, on and off some lights and different types of stuff that I've connected to it. To those, I'd say absolutely. In a work situation, I'm not sure you can ever compete with dictation, where you can't dictate fast enough compared to how fast a person can type. So that's probably not a place where you'll see that happening. But in lots of other convenient places, I'm pretty sure you'll see it become a thing. And one of the reasons I'm thinking that, let's say, Google and YouTube and stuff like that is also the smart speakers, just because you can ask for that song or you can ask that question. And it's easy. I could be sitting at my dining table and my kid asks me, how many dots does a giraffe have? And I can actually ask Google instead of trying to say, nobody really knows. But I don't know. It just came to me, that question. But stuff like that, I'm pretty sure that will be pretty common. My son gets up almost every morning and asks Google what the weather will be. I don't know why he does it, but he does it and finds it, I don't know.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah. It's control and the ability to do it, you know? It is interesting. But I was, I watched, I think it's called Finch. It's a pretty new movie with Tom Hanks, where he has he develops a robot that's an AI, and in it, you know, the AI is just kind of quote unquote born and is learning. And he asks him, like, you know, how many miles away are the moons from Saturn, whatever, some random thing. And of course, the AI knows all these quote unquote facts. yet he can't make a simple decision on some other stuff, right? And it was a really interesting thing of like, there are things computers are going to be so much better at us at knowing facts about data and things, but that thought process to be able to discern something and make a decision on something, you know, it's far more complex than we really give it to. But it is interesting of like using some things wisely in a certain ways. And the other one that dawned on me, we were talking about, is like when I lived in my other house, I had a garage and I had an Alexa device in my car. It was an Auto Echo, I forget what it's called. But I had hooked my remote control to the garage door to it. So I could be driving home and say, you know, Alexa, open the garage door. And it would, before I even, I could, because it wasn't at that point using my Wi-Fi local radio, it was going to the cloud and sending it, you know, that way. I could be down the street and tell it. So before I even got home, I didn't have to wait for the garage door to open, you know, which it sounds stupid, but I'm like, that's how, you know, much of annoying, I don't like waiting for things. And it was just cool, you know, to be able to say it and have it automatically open way ahead of you.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure, I don't know how far a garage door opener can be made to actually work, but the general idea of being able to just say it, mm-hmm. instead of taking your mind off of the road or whatever to find that
right.
device or whatever it might be. So yeah, stuff like that just makes sense. It's like I've sat in an office with lots of people so many years, and one of the things that I've brought up before is that a question pops into their head. Something on a software program, they don't remember how to do it, they haven't done it before, where I would most of the time just Google it.
Right.
They turn around and ask into the room or the guy next to them or whatever. And yeah, sure, they might know it or they may not, and they might Google it and help them figure it out or whatever it is. But that general idea, that way of just asking the question with your words instead of researching it yourself might also be a way for computers, AIs, general things to have access or help us or whatever you might say. Because, hey, computer, as they would say on Star Trek, that would probably become a general term, having systems that will listen to every conversation we have, like my smart speaker out here is probably doing right now.
Right. But of course, in Star Trek and such, they don't point out the things that have gone wrong of like, well, at least maybe they probably even do have an episode about it. But you might ask something that's actually a security thing, and there's people around you that shouldn't be hearing the results, right? Like, there's a lot of things that could go sideways and be bad.
That was an interesting sound. But yeah, I totally get that. But I would bet that in the future, we will have that sorted, because we're already thinking so much about every type of different scenario. Not that we're keeping up with the speed of how stuff in the computer world is going, but we're trying to make sure that we don't run ahead of ourselves. Even though Google and Apple and all the other people have gotten lots of information about everybody already, we're still trying to do just a bit of damage control, so to speak. But let's say you had, a small implant or something in your head, or I don't remember all the different names, but I know there are a few different things. But if you had that together with a few other different things to identify yourself for the computer to know you, and let's say it was able to actually send the sound or the image or whatever it might be to you directly, which for us on a Star Trek television show needed to be audible,
right.
As it was inside the room, it might also just be beamed directly to whichever communication device they had.
Yeah. The Google Glasses, you know.
Yeah. And right now, the Apple AirPods or whatever, stuff like that will probably become a thing.
Right.
I'm not saying that an actual optical contact lens will work. It may. It might also just be a canvas for holographic system to display stuff on. I you know, it's the future. Nobody really knows what's going to happen, but the possibilities might be there, stuff like that. So if you say it, there might be, who knows, a sound wave from that implant you have that is a unique identifiable thingy, specific wavelength that's inherable to the human ear or whatever it might be, that might be replicatable because, as you said, recordings. But you might also need to be in proximity of whatever the thing is. And if it's then sent directly to a specific MAC address device, that might get you around most of it. Is it then, is it possible to put an intermediary in between to still catch the information? Maybe. Depends on how or with the way you actually send it. If you then send it all encrypted with a high enough level of encryption, like we do on the internet, you know, the Internet of Things, just in smaller ways and more wearable. Sure.
Yeah, I'd be curious for anyone listening to this. One, what do you have that you use the voice, you know, automations? You know, do you have an Echo or a Google or something else? And what do you have in your home? Like, my thermostat is set up to it. I have several lights and fans that are wired to them, and then I have a lot of devices, you know, plus I have two Echo shows with the cameras, so I can see the Ring doorbells. I'm trying to think of like everything of, you know, the different types of devices I have. And then I have a Blink camera, which I can access. And then am I security camera outside? And then what do you do with them? Right. I mean, like, I love being able to increase the temperature or decrease the temperature without getting out of my seat. I mean, it's, God, Americans are lazy, but it is just really convenient when you're sitting somewhere and you're like, hey, that's a little chilly. Let's turn it up just a bit, you know, really nice. But yeah, I'm curious how you all use them. And do you do stuff actually from your computer that would you like functionality? What would you wish you could do? Because I think Jackie's point about the whole, the work and where you're using it is critical, right? But let's assume, especially in today's day and age with COVID, so many more people are working from home instead of in an office place, that maybe it becomes much more prevalent where it is acceptable to, not acceptable, but permissible.
Here on my phone, I can actually just depress the button here, and Siri will start, and I can ask her questions. But because I'm mostly using this when I'm out and about, I've never really gotten to use it much. I've done it in a car a few times. Ask it to show me a route to somewhere, or I might have written a text to my wife. I'm on my way. I'll be there in 20 minutes. Send to, and so on and so forth. That works okay, but it's a little bit too inconvenient because I've never gotten Siri to really act on my voice. These buzzwords or trigger words or whatever have never worked on this old piece of hardware that I have. However many times I've tried, and it's probably me trying to say Siri in Danish that probably doesn't work. I don't know. Who knows? But at least, but with Google, the Google devices here, those have worked from day one. So, yeah.
The other thing I use, because we have them in almost, well, at my old house, and it was a bigger house, we had them in every room and even several bathrooms, like the bigger bathrooms where you'd be in there, you know, getting dressed and showering and just have play music and stuff. But you can drop in, one, I can make an announcement and say, hey, dinner's ready, and it goes everywhere. Or I can use them as like an intercom. I can drop into a given room and tell my son to come, you know, do whatever, ask him a question. And that's, it's a functionality. I don't use it as often as I should, because we'll end up yelling, not yelling at me just because it's far. But it's a nice functionality.
Yeah, I scared my son one morning by doing that. He kept asking Google questions, and my daughter was sleeping and stuff like that. And I was like, hey, Google, blah, 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 broadcast, hey, Oliver, stop doing that. And I was like, oh, dad, Google knew my name. And he was like, it's me, right?
And I know you, I think you mentioned something like the Alexa. My understanding has a lot more skills that can be added compared to Google. That's one, but and Google I think is better on searching and understanding stuff than the Alexa is. But the Alexa has a like a birthday one, and you can say set it up for your son and say his favorite colors and favorite this and favorite that. And then I think like his friends have a quiz that it presents it as a quiz, and his friends at the, you know, are supposed to ask and see who gets the most of them right. But there's some really cool stuff that's in there.
My son has also really, you know, tried to figure out questions he could ask Google. So he has asked her how old she was, what gender she had, and she has some great answers to those questions. So, yeah.
Well, you know, and it brings up the point, which I don't think we actually brought up here before, but it's, to some degree, it's really, I don't know if it's, I want to say it's all good. To me, a lot of it's good is, I know we talked about this, I don't think it was in a podcast, but before you and I were talking about it, saying it's changing how we think a bit more before we phrase our question, right? Which to me is a good thing, you know, to put a little thought in what you're saying before you say it. But it's actually in some ways also helping you sort of be a programmer, right? To think about exactly what it is you're trying to say. The order matters, it's not. And in the long run, I bet it actually changes humans a bit to hopefully get us to think a little clearer.
Yeah, and I'm sure with the speed of computers and word recognition and stuff like that, where we're like, how it's hard for computers to learn how to speak. That's true. It might take us 50 years to learn the computers to do it absolutely perfect, but then they'll probably be able to do it in every language, and they will never have to learn it again, where every individual human still uses 4 years, every freaking human time to learn it. So and it's the same with driving cars and all that stuff. When the computer actually ends up learning it, done.
Right.
Forever. Right.
You and I think we talked about doctors that way too, right? And doctors can do all they can to learn and learn and learn and learn. And yet a computer, you know, they can absorb far more than any person can, far, far more. And always know, you know, go through all this crazy things that no human could ever know, and really diagnose something really well, given, you know,
there's a good reason that people like Elon Musk and people like that are talking about humans having a way to low latency, right? Our in and output speed is way too slow. Our processing speed might be okay compared to computers currently, but the speed at which we can communicate with each other or absorb information compared to how quickly a computer can exchange information. Mm-hmm. We're slowly becoming obsolete when it comes to that part of it. Then we can do different things, and we're not in that way obsolete yet, but some tasks we probably won't see humans doing in a number of years, because it wouldn't make sense anymore to ask people to do it.
Well, I mean, and that's no shocker, because There's so many things that are already that way, right? That technology in some way or another has replaced humans doing it, or at least greatly reduced the number of humans doing it.
Absolutely. I had a funny, we were watching a small series here the other day, and one of the persons in it said, and the person was being accused of murdering someone or hiring someone or doing something illegal, whatever it was, and there was sort of, yeah, and I did it, I gave the person the poison and they did whatever they were going to do with it. And then a few days later, 55,000 just appeared on my bank account. I was like, isn't that how it works? Doesn't a number on bank accounts just always appear? They don't right. just slowly build, or
it's, right?
And then 75,000 extra was there. It's just the way it was worded, like, oh, nice. This is amazing. It just appeared. But that's how it works. If you're looking at your bank statement digitally,
1 second is there. Moment,
yeah. And it's been like that for years and years and years. So, yeah. You don't go and deposit it.
A little at a time. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you, Jackie. This is interesting. And like I said, everyone, if you want to chime in how you're using voice activated, you know, programming, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. Now let's hear about it.
See you.
Bye.